Item number, SCP-388. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-388 is to be kept in a locked safe in a room guarded by at least two armed guards, instructed to refuse access to any unauthorized personnel. Use of lethal force is permitted to this end. Unless undergoing experimentation, SCP-388 is to remain outside the influence of any other SCPs demonstrating properties capable of modifying physical laws or drawing energy from unknown sources. Description: SCP-388 consists of a foldable nylon frisbee of the type commonly given away as promotional material, in this case, bearing the logo of the banana boat Suntan Lotion Corporation. SCP-388 appears to be immune to damage. During testing, it has been able to withstand high-caliber rifle shots, immersion in high-acidity baths, and sustained temperatures of 3,500 degrees Celsius. In all cases, it would spring back, unharmed, to its original shape. X-ray crystallography reveals the molecular structure of SCP-388 to be completely normal nylon, supported by a ring of metal appearing to be aluminum. SCP-388 was discovered after witnesses in a local news report in the town of claimed a power line was downed by a UFO. Agents embedded with maintenance crews investigated and found the concrete pole was sliced cleanly with no tool marks, prompting full investigation status. Aerial records obtained from NORAD revealed no abnormalities as data expunged, typically associated with data expunged. The investigation was nearly terminated until agents posing as reporters interviewed the family, originally questioned in the news report, and their child mentioned the entire incident as being caused by a frisbee. Initially skeptical, efforts were nonetheless taken to verify this claim, with initial confirmation made on data expunged. A full week of helicopter searches of a neighboring city and numerous retrievals of unremarkable frisbees from rooftops eventually yielded results. Unfortunately, Agent was fatally dismembered by SCP-388 when Agent threw the object down from the roof. Under the guise of replacing a septic tank, SCP-388 was dug up from its resting place 5.5 meters below the yard and carefully brought in for containment. SCP-388, when thrown by a human, appears to travel as a normal frisbee would for a distance of approximately 3 meters. After this distance, SCP-388 immediately begins glowing bright white and accelerates until its velocity reaches approximately meters per second. SCP-388 will proceed to cleanly slice through all intervening matter, regardless of consistency, until eventually coming to rest. Current theory holds that it loses speed due to friction between its top and bottom surfaces and the weight of material pressing down on it as it passes through objects. SCP-388 does not differentiate between matter and test subjects assigned to catch it. Addendum: inquiries into the potential use of SCP-388 as a weapon have been declined in light of the obvious difficulty of retrieving it after its first throw. Item number, SCP-387. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. Due to the nature of this object and the almost non-existent harm it poses, it is stationed in a storage container in Site-19 with a standard lock. The red tub in which SCP-387 is contained does not possess any unusual properties itself, as has been determined through testing, but SCP-387 will not duplicate itself unless at least a layer of it covers the bottom of the aforementioned container. A sheet is available for those wishing to utilize SCP-387. And access will be revoked if it is not properly restored. Description: SCP-387 is a tub of commercially available Lego, normal in design. Irregular shapes not featured in normal sets, such as circular wheels and prisms, are also available. It has no brand name, and every company interviewed by undercover agents thus far has denied ever making irregular Lego. When the tub is not full, i.e., when it is partially or almost fully emptied, the Lego will slowly duplicate themselves, stopping when the container is full. The interesting property of SCP-387 is that, when constructed by a human hand, see Addendum 387-D, the constructions will animate themselves, performing activities based on their surroundings. For example, if a Lego man, which is a man constructed using the provided humanoid parts, is placed within a car, it will begin to drive it. Further experimentation has revealed that the car, and indeed any complex machine, needs no internal engine or power source. The Lego people have some form of sentience, as they interact with each other quite readily. If left over time, the constructed people and buildings will evolve. They will take on occupations based on the buildings around them. For example, some people will become firemen and use fire trucks if the corresponding objects are there. They will also use SCP-387 to construct more things to expand their society. Humans can interact with them quite peacefully, but if a human becomes hostile to them, they will immediately cease all activity and become inanimate. SCP-387 was found in February of 2000 by Agent H. During a long train ride back to the city he lived in, Agent H idly constructed a man from SCP-387, which was in the seat beside him at the time. Several seconds later, it became animated. Agent H quickly disassembled the man and delivered the item to Site-19 for analysis, where it now remains. The security tapes from the train were confiscated and destroyed before they could be reviewed. Optional information. SCP-387 should not be given to children under the age of 10, especially if the aforementioned children are influenced by cartoons and television shows. Experiment 387A. A small community of SCP-387 is formed in a testing chamber. A plane constructed from normal Lego was placed to the side of the community. Over the next 3 hours, the following changes were observed. Several Lego men procured some equipment from SCP-387, heading over towards the plane. With incredible efficiency, the Lego men constructed what was, for all intents and purposes, a working airport, the specific pieces having been supplied by SCP-387 without visible signal. A petrol tank zoomed over to said plane, apparently filled it with fuel, despite earlier observations that vehicles constructed from SCP-387 do not require fuel, and the plane proceeded to literally take off, flying around the room at low speeds and altitude, seemingly to avoid crashing. More planes, of different make and design, were formed soon after. Addendum 387-1. Judging by this, I'd say that constructions of SCP-387 have some form of understanding of the surrounding environment, and they are able to convert existing Lego to 387. Dr. Arch. Experiment 387-B. Several young children were given SCP-387 and were given instructions to use their imagination. The children, who had their memories of this experiment removed, began constructing various objects. After having noticed that they were animate, they excitedly conferred and began building several objects that they intended to use in battling each other. These included a transformer, an M1 Abrams tank, and several expunged. The children were instantly removed, at which point the creations began to fire and eventually destroyed each other, though not after considerable effort. Addendum 387-2. How the f**k did these children gain knowledge of the workings of an M1 Abrams tank? No less expunged. I'm not responsible for cleaning out the mess those things make. If anyone is stupid enough to let children go at SCP-387, I am not recommending an upgrade to Euclid, as the constructions did not fire whilst in the presence of humans. This has been tested with adults, and proved just as correct. Dr. Arch. Experiment 387-C. The red tub that contains SCP-387 is emptied of Lego. Commercially available Lego is then placed in the tub for a minute. Constructed objects are inanimate, and remain so. SCP-387 replaced. It is noted that the Lego placed within the tub also did not duplicate itself. Experiment 387C2. A single block of SCP-387 is placed within the red tub. It does not replicate. More of SCP-387 is added until the bottom layer is covered, at which point, it began to replicate itself quite rapidly until it had been filled. The amount of SCP-387 removed from the tub continued to work. Similarly, when an amount of SCP-387 higher than the tub's capacity was placed upon the tub, it shrank until the red tub was fully filled. Addendum 3873. It appears that the red tub itself has no abilities by itself, but SCP-387 will not duplicate itself unless in that particular tub. Perhaps this is a copyright mechanism that stops copies of 387 being made. Further experimentation needed. Dr. Arch. Experiment 387D. A robotic arm was used to construct a car out of 387. It did not animate. This test was repeated with a human hand, at which point the car animated as usual. A dead hand from a recently dismembered agent was used, to no response. The hand was then heated, which still provoked no response. Addendum 3874. It appears that 387 responds to a pulse or some other detection of human life. Dr. Arch. Addendum 3875. This SCP has been in high demand for extended use, as further testing has revealed no more anomalies or features. In the personnel tested, SCP-387 has improved morale and attitude by 87%. People are really kids at heart here. As such, I'm recommending that all personnel be given free access for recreational use. Dr. Arch. Request approved. Experiment 387E. Once a normal community of 387 was constructed, a small mound of Mega Blocks, a common copy of Lego, was placed near the community. When this happened, everything constructed of 387 stopped moving, turned slowly towards the Mega Blocks, and expunged. Addendum 3876. Jesus f***ing Christ. Dr. Arch. Item number SCP-365. Object Class Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-365 is to be kept in its testing pool at all times. The door to the pool is to be locked and guarded by one security guard. Experiment requests must be approved by a Level 3 researcher. Description. SCP-365 is a green pool noodle made of polyethylene foam. By itself, it displays no unusual properties and is physically identical to a typical noodle of similar size. SCP-365's unusual properties manifest only when it is placed in a body of water. When a subject completely submerges in said body of water, they become unable to get out. Subjects report a sense of dread and describe themselves in an infinite sea, swimming endlessly in a direction and finding only more water. It is important to note that to outside observers, the subject simply seems to be flailing in place. The only way to remove a submerged person from the water is to remove SCP-365, negating its effects. All other methods of rescue have failed. Cables and ropes have exhibited an unnatural resistance and snapped. Drainage systems have failed, and human intervention has led to data expunged. Addendum 3651. SCP-365 was discovered in on date undisclosed. Retrieval personnel found it at the public pool, along with the bodies of several civilians. Because SCP-365's properties were unknown at the time, agents lost their lives. SCP-365 was eventually found and removed from the pool, and carbon monoxide from an improperly maintained water heater was used as a cover story. Addendum 3652. On date undisclosed, researcher discovered that hallway 19 of storage site 23 was flooded. Said researcher noticed water leaking from SCP-365's storage locker at a rate of 5 liters per minute. She quickly notified Dr. who opened the locker to find SCP-365 producing water from its holes. SCP-365 was subsequently moved to its testing pool, whereupon the flow of water stopped. SCP-365's containment procedures have been changed accordingly. Item number, SCP-345. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-345 is to be kept inside a secure vault at site. Seeing as the object is inert by itself, no further containment is necessary. Personnel seeking to solve SCP-345 need the permission of one level 2 personnel. SCP-345-1 is to be kept inside a 5-meter by 5-meter by 5-meter sealed room on site. Following Incident 345-1, personnel are only allowed to solve one of the 6 faces of SCP-345. Trying to solve all faces will result in reassignment to MTF Epsilon 8, the Midwives. Description: SCP-345 is a stone cube whose faces are each divided into 9 squares of equal size, and sections of which can be rotated in a fashion similar to a common puzzle toy. Each face of the cube measures 5.7 centimeters. Instead of the normal 6 colors commonly found in this kind of puzzle, the squares represent 6 different materials: an intrusive magmatic rock resembling granite, an intrusive magmatic rock resembling gabbro, an extrusive magmatic rock resembling basalt, a sedimentary rock resembling sandstone, volcanic glass resembling obsidian, and a high-grade metamorphic rock resembling granite gneiss. SCP-345 can be opened by forcibly pulling its sides apart. The cube is hollow, possessing a circular cavity 4.5 centimeters in diameter in its center. If left open for 5 seconds, SCP-345 will automatically close and shuffle itself for 2 minutes. Afterward, it may be safely handled. Note that it will not be possible to force SCP-345 open after the shuffling takes place. Solving SCP-345 is no harder than solving the common versions of the puzzle. However, if one of the faces becomes complete, one of the following situations may occur. If the completed face represents one of the magmatic rocks, SCP-345 will heat up to approximately either 1500 degrees Celsius, gabbro face, 1200 degrees Celsius, basalt face, or 900 degrees Celsius, granite face. The amount of time SCP-345 takes to cool down also greatly varies, with the basalt face being the fastest, up to 50 minutes, and the gabbro face being the slowest, up to 250 days. If the completed face represents the sedimentary rock, the cube will start shaking violently for up to 10 hours. The sound of either water running or wind howling can be heard coming from inside SCP-345 during the whole process. If the completed face represents volcanic glass, SCP-345 will heat up to approximately 900 degrees Celsius and will take up to 5 minutes to cool down. If the completed face represents the metamorphic rock, SCP-345 will suffer the same process that would happen if the granite face was completed. After cooling down, the cube will proceed to shuffle itself at high speeds, making loud grinding sounds while it does so, for up to 50 hours. After one of the processes is over, SCP-345 can be opened again, and a sculpture made of the same material that was represented by the completed face can be found inside of it. The small sculpture will always be of a planet or planetoid 4.5 centimeters in diameter. These sculptures do not resemble any currently known planet. If more than one face is completed at the same time, both corresponding processes will occur, one followed by the other. The statue created will be made of both materials. For instance, the sculpture created by completing the granite and obsidian faces at the same time had its continents made of granite and its oceans made of obsidian. SCP-345 was recovered by a Foundation agent on date undisclosed, days after the eruption of the volcano in Ecuador. Said agent claims to have found it near the base of the volcano and took it as a curiosity. He learned about the true nature of the SCP after trying to solve it, suffering third-degree burns in the process. Incident 345-1. On date undisclosed, While Dr. tested SCP-345, she managed to complete all faces by not opening the cube once a face was completed. SCP-345 proceeded to rumble for 3 minutes, after which it opened by itself. A small metal sphere, 4.5 centimeters in diameter, emerged from inside SCP-345 and hovered 3 meters from the ground. Shortly after, the sphere began rotating, accelerating to a rate of 5 meters a second. Strong gravitational forces were detected in the vicinity of the sphere, visibly affecting objects up to 15 meters away. Seconds later, a dense orange liquid with an average surface temperature of approximately 4,000 degrees Celsius began flowing from SCP-345, which proceeded to encompass the metal sphere. Afterward, another, denser liquid began flowing out of SCP-345. It also proceeded to encircle the sphere. This liquid continued to flow from inside SCP-345 until the sphere reached a diameter of 2.3 meters, at which point the flow stopped, and SCP-345 automatically closed. The resulting sphere was still slowly spinning and hovering above the ground. It was extremely dense, and its gravitational pull was strong enough to severely damage its surroundings. The temperature at the surface varied between 900 and 1600 degrees Celsius. 30 minutes later, parts of the outermost magma began to cool down, solidifying into a thin rock crust. 20 hours later, most parts of the sphere were solid rock, with small seas of lava flowing between them. Little volcanoes and mountains could also be observed. At this point, a special containment team with heat-resistant equipment was moved in to relocate the sphere to a safer room. The sphere was later designated SCP-345-1. Studies regarding the probability of its eventual development of an atmosphere are underway. Note: although at first we thought that SCP-345 had created a copy of Earth, as of date undisclosed, studies have shown that it is unlikely that SCP-345-1 will develop an atmosphere, and the composition of its magma is very different from Earth's, containing far smaller quantities of silica and aluminum, and larger amounts of titanium. It is currently unknown if the magma of other planetoids created by SCP-345 would have a similar composition. Perhaps we should have a D-class completed, preferably on an open field. Dr. Item Number: SCP-309. Object Class: Euclid. Special Containment Procedures: SCP-309 is currently stored in a secure glove box in the Level 2 Research Lab at Site. Routine physical examinations of SCP-309, as well as experiments involving small animals, may only be conducted using the glove box. Removal of SCP-309 from the glove box for testing on larger animals or humans requires the approval of Dr. or equivalent Level 4 command personnel. Human testing is restricted to D-class personnel. Description: SCP-309 is a small, plush, stuffed animal that looks as if it has been turned completely inside out. Golden-orange fur is present along the seams, while a small amount of cotton stuffing and two protruding eyes are visible on the head. The interior of SCP-309 is understuffed with cotton, giving it a flexible and cuddly feel. SCP-309 has no effect on inanimate objects. However, contact with living subjects is both dangerous and life-threatening. Humans and animals lightly brushing SCP-309 with a finger or a similarly small portion of the body display severe, non-localized discomfort for tens of minutes afterward. Humans also report feeling extreme nausea, despite the fact that SCP-309 does not induce vomiting. The discomfort and nausea are so overwhelming that even the most hardened subjects have proven unable to voluntarily maintain contact with SCP-309 for longer than a few seconds. If SCP-309 is pressed firmly against a subject, or the subject quickly picks up SCP-309 and attempts to hold it, the subject will be violently and painfully turned inside out over the course of 5 to 10 seconds. Skeletons are unaltered, but all soft tissues are inverted, such that muscles, tendons, ligaments, and various internal organs are resituated on the exterior of the body. Though not immediately fatal. The process is irreversible and universally considered painful. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.